And our first presentation will be Difflog, Beyond Deductive Methods in Program Analysis. The presentation will be given by Mukund Raghothaman, whom several of us have seen at the very beginning of this workshop with a very nice demo. So now we are going to see a bit more in-depth of this work. Mukund has graduated from University of Pennsylvania, where he's now doing postdoctoral research as well in a different group, and he has done a broad range of works, and this connects, I would say, several connects several topics that he has been involved in the past.
Thanks, Victor. Yes, as a number of you probably saw, I gave a demo. I demoed some of our tools yesterday in the morning. And although I tried to give some background, the demo was really without context. This talk is the context to all of the work that I was describing over there. The problems that we are working on are static analyzers. Automatic bug finding tools, push button. Historically, the programming language slash verification community has taken a deep interest in developing these tools. We've had projects like SLAM from Microsoft Research for Windows device drivers, ASTRAE to verify avionics software for Airbus, Coverity, which tries to verify enterprise applications, and Facebook Infer, as a number of attendees over here are familiar with. Now, writing static analyzers is hard. What do we expect of these tools? Well, ideally, they should identify the most serious bugs in the program. They should produce no false alarms. And they should scale to very large code bases. Any two of these is possible. The challenge comes in putting all three of them together. We saw several talks yesterday about how program reasoning tools routinely miss bugs. These things have also affected them in practice. A few years ago, you might remember that there was this massive vulnerability in the OpenSSL crypto library called Heartbleed, which leaked sensitive data. It remained in the OpenSSL code base for roughly 3 years, from 2011 to 2014. Most of all, OpenSSL is an open source project. It's not just open source, it's also a critical component of the security infrastructure. It's, as such, it's the target of routine software audits. Coverity has a pro bono tool called Coverity Scan. They routinely scan these elements of the software stack for security bugs. Why didn't any of these static analysis tools discover the Heartbleed bug? Now, as most of you are doubtless familiar, developing static analysis tools are hard. Most of the time, the properties that we are trying to verify, they're undecidable. Forget undecidability, a more pressing concern is scalability. The programs that we are dealing with are hundreds of thousands of lines of code large. Static analysis designers make aggressive trade-offs. Ideally, we expect analysis tools to only report true positives. Whenever there is a serious bug in the code base, we expect it to report it to us. If it does not report something, we believe that there is no bug in the code base. Ideally, we want just true positives and true negatives. What real static analysis tools also display are false positives and false negatives. There's a bit of confusion in the community over what to call each of these things. In my talk, I'll say that a tool that produces false positives is incomplete. A tool which produces false negatives does not report bugs, even though there's something in the there's a bug in the program. I'll call them unsound. Really balancing these is the job of the static analysis designer. How many false positives do we have? How many false negatives do we have? How scalable is the tool? So Coverity conducted a postmortem after the Heartbleed bug. They had the following to say. They said it can be difficult to do without introducing large numbers of false positives or scaling performance exponentially poorly. In this case, it was balancing these and other factors in the analysis design which caused us to miss this defect. Okay. So let's look at how these analysis tools are actually built. Traditionally, there is an analysis designer sitting down at a whiteboard in front of a computer screen who comes up with an analysis A. They have some notion in their mind of what kinds of programs they are analyzing, what kinds of bugs they want to report, what are serious and what are benign. They express this analysis in some format. The vehicle we will choose, our poison of choice, is this formalism called data log. So we take an analysis which is written in data log. We take a program P, apply the analysis to the program, and report a set of results. We return this to the to the programmer who wants their code to be analyzed. Traditionally, this is how the workflow has been. As we saw yesterday, we also want, in the Facebook info talk, programmers expect more. The user is not a passive element in the system. They don't just want a set of reports. They actually want to interact with the system. What we have been developing over the last few years in our group at Penn has been to take this monolithic block over here and split it into two things. We learn, there are elements of the analysis which have to be learned. Analysis designers typically make these seat of the pants decisions. Oh, I believe that programmers write code in these ways. None of these design decisions are ever validated by data. So ideally, we want to learn our analysis from a corpus of, from a semi-labeled corpus of data. On the other side, we want to actively involve the programmer in inspecting the results. We don't just want to give them a set of results. We want to tell them which alarms they should be focusing their attention on, how to prioritize either by relevance, severity, likelihood of being a real bug, or so on. So what we offer really is then data-driven analysis design on the left, and on the right, a framework to prioritize alarms and to generalize from feedback. And what allows us to do all of this is this broad overarching framework called Difflog. I started by saying we would express our analysis in data log. Well, I lied, we are extending data log to this continuous domain called Difflog, which will really be the content of the rest of this talk. But before I describe what Difflog is, let's look inside one of these analyses, the anatomy of an analysis. We needed to pick one. Our group has a lot of expertise in concurrency and data race bugs. These are also bugs that are notoriously difficult for programmers to diagnose and write correct code. We are dealing with concurrency. What is the simplest thing you want to know about a concurrent program? Which two statements can execute in parallel? Can two statements execute in parallel? Now, you might think about this in terms of deduction rules. Here is a cartoon of a deduction rule. If I know that two statements in a program can execute in parallel, P1 and P2, and if I know that P3 can execute immediately after P2, then I can conclude that P1 and P3 can execute can themselves execute in parallel. This is something written in data log. Now, the flavor of this should be familiar to you if you have looked at any paper in type systems, any type inference rule. Even if the specific language is different, the emotions it evokes should be familiar. So in particular, in this example here, we see that if we know somehow that L1 and L2 can execute in parallel, from the program text, we can immediately see that L3 can execute immediately after L2. Applying this rule R allows us to conclude that L1 and L3 can execute in parallel. Now, data log is not just something we are using. A number of static analysis tools out there, Dupe, Souffle, Flix, Semmel. We have a number of attendees in the audience from Semmel here. So if you are skeptical about the relevance of data log to describe, to reason about code, maybe they'll be eager to engage with you. Okay, so we have an analysis rule in this style. Applying it is really what you would expect, how you would expect it to work. We start off with this collection of facts we know about the program. These are things that we could just read off the program text. Other analysis could tell us some facts about the program. We start from these. We keep applying these this deduction rule to the program. We conclude new things about behaviors we expect the program to have. And we stop when there's nothing new to be concluded, a so-called fixed point. At this point, we see that, oh, we concluded L1 and L3 may be in a data race with each other. L1 and L4 may be in a data race with each other, and so on. This really is the substance of how the analysis that we consider look. Again, this is a cartoon analysis. The real analysis that we consider, this is one analysis rule. The analysis that we consider have hundreds. We took this analysis, we applied it to the Apache FTP server. This is an open source, highly concurrent web server. We expect it to have a lot of bugs and also to be an important target for code audits. We applied a data race detector called CORD, which has analysis written in data log, and we obtained a collection of 522 alarms. Each of these alarms, of course, has a description associated with it. So, for example, you could say, there's possibly a data race on the field is passive in between the lines connection.java191 and connection.java106. If we look at all of these 522 alarms, 75 of them, or just 75 of them, are true positives, and the remaining false alarms. Now, developers, if they see this kind of true positive rate, they are going to be put off, they are going to revolt and stop using the tool. We promise to make the situation better. To be able to make the situation better, we need to understand where the problem arises. We know at some conceptual theoretical level far off that undecidability, scalability, there is some approximation happening. False alarms have to arise. What is the physical process? How do they arise? So let's just look at this example. I showed you this toy deduction rule over here. We can apply that to this trio of statements. Even if we know that L1 and L2 can execute in parallel, and there are executions of the code where L3 can execute immediately after L2. But what is this saying? That L3 can execute only after L2 only when there is no other thread present. So even though both of the antecedents of this deduction rule are true, the conclusion need not hold. The rule is taking true hypothesis and producing a spurious conclusion. This rule is in some sense the cause of the incompleteness in the analysis. You might think that, this is a stupid thing for the developer to have done. Well, if you think about it, how would you get rid of this error? You would have to analyze SMT conditions along individual paths. Path-sensitive analysis are notoriously harder than path-insensitive ones. This is not a mistake in the part of the analysis designer. This was a deliberate design decision. So these incorrect intermediate conclusions, now we just saw an incorrect intermediate conclusion forming, they accumulate and lead to false alarms downstream. If most of the time the analysis designer says, there are not too many false alarms, let's ignore it. What happens if there are too many of them? Well, they sit down, refine the analysis, they use more elaborate rules. All of this requires another popular PLDI paper. It makes the analysis computationally expensive, and how effective it is depends on what kinds of programs you're analyzing, what coding idioms there are in the program, and so on. Right, and really all of this is something that would be relevant in a POPL or a PLDI talk, not in a talk on ML4P. Our observation is that if we actually look at the derivation graph of the programs, these two alarms over here, they share a root cause. We believed that L1 and L3 can execute in parallel, therefore we believe L1 and L3 have a data race. Therefore, we also believe that L1 and L4 have a data race. Given that they share these root causes, they're also correlated in their ground truth. The word correlation should bring to mind the idea of statistics and probability, and that is how it connects to the theme of this workshop. The question that we really want to ask is, the developer saw this alarm report race L1, L3. They said, no, this is a false alarm. How do we generalize from there? Now, traditionally, how these static analysis have been written is by accumulating a set of conclusions. This derivation graph, even though I show it on the board over here, it's just an artifact that they threw away. It's a side effect. We claim that this derivation graph has important information for us to introspect, and preserving this thing, the provenance of these alarms, is how we can go forward. So I started by showing you this figure where I described an extension of data log to the continuous domain, got sidetracked a bit describing just what data log is. Let's focus on this, the right side of the figure. How do we interactively, so how do we generalize from this feedback that the developer is giving us? So interactive ranking, and really this brings us to the substance of this workshop, marginal inference. How do we perform marginal inference over these things? So if you remember the demo I showed yesterday, it was in this setting. There was an analysis which produced a number of alarms. A small fraction of them were real bugs. The developer, so we, instead of just producing a set of alarms as static analysis tools traditionally do, what we are doing is ranking them according to their probability. What is the, how likely is it that this is a real bug? In this case, A1 is the alarm at the top of the list, and we have 99.3% confidence that it's a true bug. The developer looks at it and says, no, that's not a real bug. Now, we don't preserve this list. We recompute a list. What is the probability of the remaining alarms given not A1? Probability of A1 given not A1 is 0, so automatically that alarm drops to the bottom. But it doesn't just bring itself down. As we saw yesterday, it has a cascade effect. Other alarms go down as well. In particular, the second alarm that we see at the top of the list has only 78% confidence. But if you actually see where these little orange true positives are, they are affected much less than the other alarms. So they start to congregate towards the top. This process continues, and within a few iterations, like we saw yesterday, all of the true positives rise to the top of the ranking. So the key question really is how we extract this kind of probabilistic model from the, I said that, we preserve this graph. How do we extract this probabilistic model from the derivation graph? Also, we said that, this rule, it's incomplete. And analysis designers have known this. They write incomplete rules, and they know that they're writing incomplete rules. Really, what we do is quantify that incompleteness. How incomplete is it? How likely is it to produce a false conclusion? We postulate that these rules misfire in statistically regular ways across the whole corpus. So what we say is instead of the logical statement, if A and B, then C, we treat it probabilistically. Even if both antecedents hold, then we believe the conclusion only with some small probability, 0.95. 0.95 is strictly less than 1.0. It's possible now for the conclusion to be false even if all of the antecedents are true. And this 0.95, in some sense, measures how often does this rule produce a false conclusion. Now, once we resolve that, this is a nice probabilistic interpretation of that statement, we can building conditional probability distributions is rather straightforward. What is the probability of pair L1, L3, given that both of its antecedents are true? 0.95. The conditional probability should still sum up to 1, so the probability of not pair given the same hypothesis is 0.05. In this case, there's no other way to derive pair L1, L3, so if either one of the antecedents fails, we know for sure that L1 and L3 can't execute in parallel. We're making this assumption that the analysis is sound underneath. And again, the probability should sum up to 1, so each row, the numbers sum up to 1. Once we agree to doing that, we go back to this derivation graph, we treat each conclusion that we have, each intermediate conclusion, as a Boolean-valued random variable. And now you could imagine living in one of a number of worlds. In each world, some of these conclusions are true, others are false. We want to know we want to assign a probability to each of these worlds. How do we do that? Well, we divide it into each of its factors. So what is the value of race L1, L4? Let's say it was true. So what's the probability of race L1, L4 given the truth values of its parents? What is the probability? Multiply that with what's the probability of not pair L1, L4. Let's say we are living in a world where pair L1, L4 is false. So what's the probability of that given the truth values of its parents? And so on. So it's this giant factoring that you should be familiar with if you've ever looked at a Bayesian network or a graphical model before. There are a number of details now here which I will skip. This graph is not really acyclic. Bayesian networks are acyclic. Scalability now of marginal inference is an issue. a lot of the things that we describe in this paper that we presented at PLDI 3 weeks ago, I will jump straight ahead to the experimental evaluation. So we tested this, as I mentioned, on a data race detector for Java and an information flow analysis for...
I was just wondering, how do you get the prior distribution?
Oh, there is no prior distribution. So what we assume is all of the input hypothesis are, we believe they are true. And so it's just the rules. Each rule, so it's just the rules that have the probabilities attached to them. The prior is just the no evidence distribution. We can get by mining a corpus. Or by running an expectation maximization algorithm. So we have a number of alarms on a corpus. We know which of those alarms are true. What we want to find out is what's the probability of these latent variables, what is the probability of these rules correctly firing across all of them. So it can be done by a straightforward implementation of expectation maximization.
So you have a golden set of true positive and false positive, is that what you're saying?
For training, we need some labeled data. We don't really need too much. In fact, a lot of these experiments will even work if you set all of the rule probabilities to something subjective, 99%. And where the method really starts working is because of the feedback loop. What is the probability of the alarm given that the developer told us that this other thing was false? So yeah, I don't know if I really answered your question, but for example, par L1, L2. So let's take next L2, L3 over here. This is a statement that we can just read off the program. That has a probability of 1.0. But now if we look at par L1, L3, the probability of that is probability of the rule R correctly firing times the probability of par L1, L2. So we don't really need a prior distribution. The prior distribution is implicit. We get it for free. The real magic numbers are in the probabilities that the rules fire correctly.
That's what I meant. Yeah.
The probability is on the rule. So this we get by expectation maximizing. So, let's think of a couple of different worlds. Let's imagine that we had very, very extensively labeled data. We don't, but let's imagine we did. Now we just look at every instance of this rule. How often does it produce a true conclusion? How often does it produce a false conclusion? That fraction is all that we are interested in. We are in a less well-labeled world. We have these latent variables. So now we bring expectation maximization into play. What is the likelihood of this? What is the likelihood of this distribution of labels given what I believe about the world, and find the rule probabilities that maximize the likelihood over the training data? We can take it offline. So these were fairly large programs, 40 to 600,000 lines of code. The Dacapo benchmark suite that IBM put out a few years ago, and a lot of malware for the Android operating system. 16 of these benchmarks, what you see, these numbers at the top are how many alarms the analysis reported. The orange bars are what fraction of those are really true positives. We are performing alarm inspection in this kind of interactive process. The developer looks at an alarm, indicates whether it's true or false, we re-rank. How many alarms does the developer have to look at before discovering all true positives? That is the blue bar that you see over here. So typically, we have with this tool, the user needs to inspect about roughly 70% fewer false alarms than without any tool support. And in some cases, things like LU index, it's not that the tool timed out, it's really that the bar is so short that you can't see it. And Australia, the dramatic reductions in the inspection burden on some specific benchmarks. So I focused on this part of the figure for now. Analysis design. I started the talk by saying analysis design is hard. So we have some work in progress on this as well right now, and I'll describe it in some detail. How do we make some of these design decisions? So a theme in the first part of this talk was really how we take this kind of deductive system data log and push it into the continuous domain through the vehicle of probabilities. We started with the data log program. We assigned a weight to each rule. These weights somehow induced a weight over each fact, over each output conclusion that we did. This is an example of a pointer analysis. Now we are not in the realm of concurrency, but what objects can refer to what. The details are irrelevant. All that matters is that we went from a deductive system to a continuous system. The continuous, by attaching weights to each of the rules, we now have weights on each of the conclusions that we produce. Traditionally, people have thought of program synthesis in the enumerative style. They decide to include a rule or not. They may temporarily make a commitment. They explore what happens. If this commitment fails, then there is some system to backtrack. Let me generalize a lot. This is how a lot of program synthesis papers work. Can we instead optimize for these values? We are in the machine learning workshop. We love numerical methods, gradient descent and Newton's method. Can we use them to do program synthesis instead? In fact, more than just as a novelty, a lot of these the underlying analysis problems are undecidable. We know that there is no program that fits the data. How do we deal with noise? How do we still get a well-behaved program in this space? Okay, so I promised something, but then let me say that this would be a very bad idea. Marginal inference is one of those canonical hard problems. If you open a textbook on graphical models, the first thing you'll see is that a Bayesian network is acyclic. The second thing you'll see is that marginal inference is sharply complete. Gradient descent would involve repeatedly performing marginal inference. This would not be feasible at all. Why? Let me reflect back a little. Why is marginal inference hard? Because independence assumptions don't always hold. We would like to be able to say probability A intersection B is probability A times probability B. That is a false statement. Let us make it true. So the solution that we have is to evaluate values not over the probability space, but over the Viterbi semiring instead. Really, the data log program has this flavor. When is a tuple derivable? If there is some derivation tree of which it is the conclusion, how do we evaluate a single clause in a derivation tree if all of its antecedents are true? So there's this something and something and something, a giant OR over all of the alternatives. We replace the ands and the ors with a different semiring, a semiring of our choice. Here we choose the Viterbi semiring. We assign weights. Remember, we had also assigned weights to individual rules. So here's the rule weight, WG, times the weight of all of the hypothesis going into the rule firing. Look at all possible rules that can derive the tuple. Take the maximum over these. This is now a continuous space. I also claim without proof that this is almost everywhere differentiable. And so we can learn these by your favorite numerical optimization scheme. We chose gradient descent, and again, I'm glossing over a number of engineering issues. How do we compute these gradients by actually preserving the provenance polynomial? So when I mentioned this word a couple of times, provenance, I hand-waved it away by saying it's just the derivation graph. Actually, the database community has a very well understood notion of what provenance is. It corresponds to exactly interpreting the semantics of data log over a semiring of your choice. I'm simplifying a little over there, but that'll do for now. So we implemented this system. And we tested it on several example analysis. Can we learn these from input-output data? What I show here is how long we take with a Difflog-based Newton's method scheme. And what I show over here is the previous state of the art, this interactive satisfiability-based learning system called ALPS that's going to appear in FSE in a few weeks. As you will see, there are dramatic improvements in synthesis time over the state of the art. Let me conclude the talk at this point. What I describe. Oh.
I had a question on you take the formula which is non-differentiable and you translate it to something non-differentiable there, right?
Yes.
The max, right?
So yes.
With these three rights, like sometimes There is a, what is the property of the rewrite? Is it, if you find a solution on the right function, that it's, there is a solution to the left one? Or
yes, so we have all of this thing on reinterpreting. So let's go back to this.
Like, is the function optimal at the satisfying assignment?
Yes, yes. So if, so what, ideally we want these output values to be 1.0. For things in the reference output, we want them to be 0.0 for things not in the reference output. So if we have a program that does that, we can throw away the weights, and what we get is a traditional data log program that does this. So there's this tight connection between the data log semantics and the difflog semantics. I'm running out of time, so let me quickly, So the idea was to build on this notion of semi-ring provenance and associate rules with tokens and capture alarm correlations in this way. I showed two applications of this, but actually the number of applications, the things that we are thinking of doing with this are far more than just these two. In the Facebook info talk, we noticed that one of the difficult things about user interaction is that code is not static. It continuously evolves. I believe that provenance is the way to think about what alarms are new and what alarms are old. In fact, we have a bias in this community towards reasoning about programs. Programs are not the only complex systems around. Think of a computer network or your favorite complex system. These things are not just complex, they're also over multiple jurisdictions. AT&T doesn't want to reveal its network topology to Comcast. If something bad happens in the network between AT&T and Comcast, how do you determine who is at fault? Fault localization in complex systems. This is an inherent, I believe that probabilistic methods provide a good window to this. This whole notion of combining numerical optimization and CDCL, I would love to hear your thoughts on this as well. I'll stop here. Thank you.
We have time for minus three questions.
I just had a question about this going from forward chaining semantics for data log going to continuous case.
What do you mean by clause matching?
So basically, how do we define this thing that a clause is derivable from a set of rules in the continuous space? How is that included?
Oh, so it's derivable if all of the antecedents have weights greater than 0.0. Because it's multiplication, it's the zero of the semi-ring. If any of the antecedents, so what you would traditionally think of as false is the zero of the semi-ring. If any of the antecedents has weight zero, it means that that particular antecedent was not derivable. So we can't fire this rule anyway. But if all of them have strictly positive weight, then this rule can fire, and we can derive the conclusion. Yeah, exactly. So we did not have to invent an evaluation algorithm for Difflog. We picked up the database theory textbook, picked up the semi-naive evaluation algorithm, and that is, we just modified it in a few places. We changed all boo. We added the data type double in a few places, right?
So this mixed continuous optimization, this is like a huge area of optimization, right?
Oh yes. So sorry. The thing that we are using is Newton's method, not gradient descent. When I present the conclusions over here, these are with Newton's method.
Which one?
The Difflog synthesis times.
No, but which optimization algorithm is this?
This is given. So I give you an input collection of facts. I give you a soup of candidate rules. Determine which subset of these rules will transform this input collection to a reference output. Use the L2 norm.
I meant like that there is this OBJSFB and others that deal with hard constraints, like box constraints.
Oh yeah, so we just the most vanilla version of Newton's method. Nothing fancy at all.
Okay.
could, in interest of time, then let's